Happy to have you with us here for your 1A State Baseball Championships. Tuscola St. Anthony coming to you from O'Brien Field in downtown Peoria. St. Anthony, 30 wins, 8 losses and a tie. Tuscola, 24-13. Dave Bernhardt along with Mark Lindo back with you here in Peoria. And Mark, when you take a look at these two teams, it is truly a dream come true. First of all, for St. Anthony, they made a promise to their three seniors, we're going to win this championship ball game. For Tuscola on the other side, the rich tradition in football, a first place finish in 2009. In 2010-2011, this group of seniors finished second. There's some sort of unfinished business here.
Well, no doubt, and both these programs have history, both in baseball and overall athletically. So winning breeds, winning success brings success, no doubt. And these two teams played very solid baseball games yesterday. You know, Tuscola came out with 10 runs on 10 hits. Effingham, 6 runs and on 7 hits. So they move the baseball. Solid pitching. Both teams have deserved to be here and proven that. And both teams got a couple horses on the hill today, which should lead them to each having their own respective confidence.
Tuscola, the visitors in this ball game. This is their starting lineup. They'll get it going with the speedy Dan Yoakum. Philip Meyer can handle it in center field. Dylan Hole does the pitching today. He was a shortstop yesterday. TJ Onstott, the designated hitter. Nolan Walsh in right. Josh Brookins, the first baseman. Then Cameron Westjohn gets a start today at third base with Hole on the mound. Tommy Watson and Jimmy Knight round out that starting lineup for Tuscola, and they will have to face Reed Willenborg. Now, I'm not sure if he's 1 or 1A, but his coach, Chris Lemon, Kenny Miller, is very confident with what this young man can do.
See his starts up there, so he's been very familiar with taking the ball to begin a ball game. 8-5, superlative earned run average right in front of you. And then how about strikeouts to walks? Read it and weep if you're an opposing hitter, because that is flat-out good numbers. Any pitcher wants 2-1. He's almost 3-1. He can strike you out. He can get himself out of jams. So a very power-type pitcher is Reed Willenborg.
And don't be fooled by those 5 losses. In 4 of those losses, his team scored a combined 3 runs. So he has pitched against some of the best teams around, and he gets Tuscola here this afternoon. There's Duff Hole, the head coach for Tuscola. Hole in his second year as a head coach, 37 wins and 32 losses. He has coached Little League for over 20 years in Tuscola, and now he has his team playing for a state title.
Duff Hole, very animated, much energetic. He really exhorts his team pitch by pitch, play by play.
Leading it off will be Dan Yoakum. Yoakum, a shortstop for Tuscola. As we said, he is a speedy one. He can get on and make things happen. Yesterday, Yoakum, 0-2, did score a run, and he walked one time.
Yoakum on the season, 32 runs. So as you mentioned, the speedy guy, he knows what he's doing. When he gets on base, a lot of good things happen.
Just misses from Willenborg. Well, Reed Willenborg, he along with Ben Heck, their top two pitchers, they decide which games they're going to pitch. And yesterday, Heck said, you know what, I'll take the semifinal, and worked out pretty well for Heck. He struggled early, then came on strong, only giving up 5 hits, striking out 11 in that 6-2 win over Alton Marquette. Willenborg misses again. It's 3-2.
So you kind of described a heck of a job, huh, from Ben? How about that? Yeah, he basically that first inning, he had a little bit of struggles. He settled down and just Katie barred the door. He slammed it.
And that ball hits him. It would have been ball 4. Down to first base goes Yoakum. 36 stolen bases. He has not been caught this year. Philip Meyer comes to the plate.
Yoakum has a green light, and Philip Meyer, the fine athlete that he is, tough to hit in this 2-hole because you want to swing away at times and get greedy, but you got to give Yoakum a chance to steal a base here or there.
The All-State quarterback, 2-for-4 yesterday with a run scored. He shows bunt, pulls it back, and takes a strike.
Willenborg's got to be careful that he comes to a full set. He knows how much Yoakum can run. He's got to come to a full set and not be called for a balk.
Yoakum with the stolen base yesterday pushes the total to 37. He stays. Hole gets it down to the right side. That will do the trick. Willenborg gets the tag, and that advances Yoakum to scoring position. So they elect to go the safe route and go sacrifice bunt, then Meyer does his job.
So we talked about the quick start yesterday, and guys go ahead and set the table, and there's a runner on base now.
Here's your defense for St. Anthony. Jared Having, Michael Cabas, and Austin Buescher, your outfield. Ben Heck goes to shortstop today, and it's Eli Dosenberg behind the plate. Neil Williams over at third base in this ballgame for the Bulldogs. At the plate, it's Dylan Hole. Hole yesterday scored three runs, had one hit and four at-bats. He looks down at his father down there in the third base coach's box. Williams backhands it in foul territory.
Kaboom.
Aces on the board. Number 11. One ball, one strike, one out. Chris Lemon gets a good look there, the head coach from the St. Anthony dugout in the third base side of O'Brien Field. Pitch to Hall to the shortstop. And across has been hecked. That little wrap on that right elbow. Makes the play, gets the out. Yoakum has to stay at second.
Ben Hecht, very sure-handed, went down to a knee to catch that ball. That's something you would teach, and it ended up being a much closer play because Hole runs pretty well, but he did indeed get the out.
T.J. Onstott, the designated hitter. He's batting for the catcher, Tristan Williams. A chance for an RBI here. Yesterday, Onstott had one run batted in, scored a couple of runs, had a hit and two in three at-bats.
Onstott would normally be a catcher, not a DH, but he was injured his junior year in football and then again his senior year.
To right field. Having right there and make the easy catch. And that's an easy first inning for Reed Willenberg. Survives the leadoff walk. Yoakum advanced to second, and that's where he stayed. We'll go to the bottom of the first. It's St. Anthony's turn here in your 1A championship. Wonderful day here. Temperature in the upper 70s, just shy of noon here in downtown Peoria. And for Effingham St. Anthony, they make the trip to Peoria, and this is the batting order that they will run out there for their state championship appearance. First time that Effingham St. Anthony has been in the state championships. Having, Cabas, and Hecht. And you see Willenberg, the cleanup hitter, also doing the pitching today. Buescher, Lorenz, and then wrapping it up with Williams, Dosenbrock, and Alex Holscher. Holscher doing the designated hitting for the first baseman, Charlie Schultz. We talked about Dylan Hole in many different ways. There's his pitching numbers this year. One of the aces for Tuscola.
Well, those numbers speak for themselves. You see the 14 starts, so no stranger is he to the hill as well. He can punch out by virtue of those strikeouts. 65 on the season. Another real good ratio. Only 17 walks. Won't beat himself. 2.58 earned runs. So people have at certain times, you know, put the ball in play. But again, you're talking about two of the top class 2A teams in Illinois, and they're going to make some plays behind each respective pitcher.
Jared Having getting set to step in against the right-handed offerings of Hole. The one thing with Hole on the mound for Tuscola and his head coach, Dad Duff, says, you know, when he pitches, that's a good thing. But the flip side of that is their defense isn't quite as good, just the way you have to maneuver people, because Hole, the outstanding shortstop for the Warriors.
Yeah, he was a joy to watch. And like most state tournaments, we have seen some outstanding center field play and some outstanding shortstop play in this tournament. Usually that's where you see your strength and your best athletes is up the middle.
Got to look at a very happy man there. That's the head coach for St. Anthony, Kenny Miller, in his third year, 64 wins and 42 losses. This is the sixth appearance for St. Anthony in the state finals. They finished fourth in 1991 with Dave Bartlett at the helm, then came back under Craig Carr and finished third. This is their first appearance in the finals since then. So a 20-year absence for the Bulldogs.
Bulldogs were 16-19 in 2011. Lost the very first game of the regional. They've come a long way in 1 year.
Jared Having at the plate. He was 2-for-4 yesterday. Scored a couple of runs. Seven hits for St. Anthony yesterday in that win over Alton Marquette, and all seven hits came from their first five batters in their order. A bit too wide for Having to even think about going for that one. Hayden will be followed by Michael Cabas and then Ben Hecht. Hale, that deliberate windup, and is ringing up Having on strikes. That froze Jared Having, out number one. Now we'll bring up Michael Cabas, the center fielder. Cabas 1-for-4 with a run scored yesterday. Just a bit outside, our umpires in this state championship ball game. Stan Bruchard behind the plate, Bob Facker at first, and Dave Hazley is over at third base. Defensively for Tuscola, Philip Meyer anchors a great outfield in center field. Shortstop today for Tuscola, Dan Yoakum. Cam Westjohn is over at third base today, so Westjohn moves into the lineup with Hole going to the mound. Count now 3-0 on Cabas.
Have a great chance to see somewhere in the area of 18 to 20 strikeouts today between these two pitchers. And right now, a Hole falling in the hole, 3-0. Base on balls are going to be key today.
Michael Cabas at the plate, excellent soccer player, salutatorian. Talked about how St. Anthony, their underclassmen, made a promise to the seniors to win a state championship. Cabas was part of the motivation for that. So he takes this pitch inside. He, along with Reed Willenborg, a basketball player, they stood up in front of the baseball team prior to the season and explained how it felt to have their seasons end early. And how the idea that this is the last time you're with this particular group of teammates, let's go out in a big way. And the underclassmen said they were dedicating the postseason and the entire season to their seniors. They wanted them to go out. They promised them to go out with a state championship.
30 wins on the board, and hopefully for St. Anthony's fans, counting. What a season, what a ride it's been.
One of the juniors on that team is at the plate right now. That's Ben Hecht. Junior shortstop. Yesterday he was a pitcher, but at the plate he was 2-for-4 with two runs batted in, a couple of runs scored. Inside to Hecht, who yesterday picked up that pitching win, as we mentioned, in seven innings, struck out 11, walked four, gave up a couple of runs and five hits. Picked up his 11th win of the year against no losses. This ball goes high into the air to left field. Jimmy Knight near the line. That's two outs. Jimmy Knight made an excellent catch yesterday deep in foul territory in the left field corner. Not much room to operate, and he chased it down. One of five players out of the six seniors on the Tuscola football team who played a football team the last 3 years, and they brought home a state trophy each time. This is Reed Willenborg at the plate. Willenborg yesterday a hit and four at-bats, drove in a run. And he was not expecting that breaking ball from Hole.
35 RBIs on the year, and he has extra base power, six doubles, two triples, and four home runs.
Long set by Hole. Runner at first is Michael Cabas. Hole this time gets the ball to the plate a little bit quicker.
Had him on the stopwatch, 1-3-1 on a curveball. You want to be under 1-2-5, 1-2-7 on a curveball, so he's a little bit more if he doesn't want Cabas to get a running start on a steal.
He has two strikes on Willenborg.
Willenborg just not a good pass at that baseball, a little bit frustrated with himself. Don't know if he's picking up the rotation or the spin.
And he's rung up on strikes, right there in a perfect spot in the strike zone. Dylan Hole gets two strikeouts. They were both looking. So each team put a runner on in the first inning. Neither team scored. We've completed one in your 1A championship. Tuscola, St. Anthony, all zeros.
Up, college is hard. Down, those books are heavy.
My sport is football, but my passion is education.
Right up here.
So every year, I take promising high schoolers on a college tour to show them that higher education means a brighter future.
My name is Nnamdi Asamoah. I don't just wear the shirt, I live it.
Find out how you can live United for Education. Give, advocate, volunteer. Go to liveunited.org.
Do you wear this?
The main entrance of O'Brien Field, the site of the Class 1A State Baseball Championships, the home of Bradley University Baseball, as well as the Peoria Chiefs of the Class A Midwest League, the Class A affiliate of the Chicago Cubs, where everybody hopes to get, and two teams remain in Class 1A, Tuscola Warriors and St. Anthony Bulldogs. With Mark Lindo, I'm Dave Bernhard. We'll start the top of the second with Nolan Walsh, the right fielder for the Warriors. Reed Wullenberg on the mound. You've already seen early here how both these pitchers working the corners.
You would expect pitching to dominate this game. High school baseball, though, expect the unexpected on any given day.
Walsh holds up on the swing, and the count goes to 2-0. Yesterday, Walsh, big day. Well, he's rung up on the appeal. It was a delayed appeal as I'm looking down. And I was expecting the next pitch. Instead, it's a strike call, a ball and a strike. Walsh yesterday, two hits and three at-bats, scored a couple of runs, knocked into. That was part of that 10-2 win over Lena Winslow. And once again, we get an appeal that goes the way of St. Anthony.
Walsh comes in hitting 389, so he can do some damage with the lumber.
And he'll go down swinging. Wullenberg staying away. First strikeout of the game for Reed Wullenberg, his 100th of the season.
Pretty impressive. He's got the ability to get you with a hard breaking ball. He's got the ability to get you with some giddy up a mid to upper 80s fastball.
Josh Brookins come to the plate 1-for-3 yesterday. Brookins, one of those five football players. He had 17 tackles in the state championship football game this year for Tuscola. That was a 47-14 loss at the hands of Dakota. There's a fastball right there. Boy, wherever Dazenbrock puts the glove, that's where Wullenberg is hitting it.
Yeah, attack the strike zone. That's what Wullenberg is doing right now, just staying very aggressive with his pitching.
And he was ready to go. Brookins was not.
Brookins is trying to break the rhythm that Wullenberg is enjoying right now, pitching with a great deal of rhythm.
To the right side, Jacob Lorenz on the 4-3 putout, two up, two down.
That just shows a kind of velocity because Brookins goes 4-3. A lot of times we talk about hitting the ball where it's pitched. Brookins basically hit that ball out of the glove of Dazenbrock because of the velocity right there of Wullenberg. He's not able to get a solid pass on the baseball, that at bat.
With two outs, that brings us to Cam Westjohn. Westjohn did not play yesterday, the 5'10 junior, 287 batting average. The reason he did not play yesterday, Jacob Barr was on the mound, and I, of course, put Dylan Hole in the defensive lineman in the infield.
Westjohn just two extra base hits all season long, and you see the outfield two outs playing deep because they're basically have a no doubles mindset. If he drops something in front, fine, but they don't want any kind of extra base hit to move a runner to scoring position with two outs.
Wullenberg, nothing down the middle, and he's down the count here, 3-1. Yeah. Ball's hit hard to right field, line drive, but it's right at the right fielder, Having. And as the top half of the first inning came to a close with a line out to Having, so does the top half of the second. No score after an inning and a half here in Peoria, your 1A state championship ball game on IHSA.TV. Cool day, but very sunny here in Peoria. The St. Anthony fans, along with Tuscola fans, enjoying the between innings musical entertainment and enjoying the chance to be out here on the final day of the high school baseball season for Class 1A, and it's the state championship.
Those young ladies having a blast, as are their gentlemen they're representing and fighting for today and cheering for, as a championship is on the line.
Austin Buescher to lead things off for St. Anthony, be followed by Jacob Lorenz and Neil Williams. We'll get a shot of them at some point today, but Tuscola, what a great weekend it's been for their athletics. Their girls softball team also in the state finals. They were playing just across the river in East Peoria. And for Tuscola girls, they finished in fourth place. They lost today 4-1, and now they're coming down the aisle right near the dugout for Tuscola, getting a big hand from the Tuscola fans. There they are. How about that? They've got their fourth place medals. They lost 4-1 to Milledgeville earlier today. They hustled on over here, and I mean hustled, to get to the state championship ball game, and now supporting their boys team. That is really a cool sight.
Yeah, you really can't describe. Actually, I kind of sent a little bit of chill up and down.
Yeah.
They walk in with their medals, and even though they tasted defeat, they know they have a state medal around their neck, and they're here for the guys that they've basically grown up with, the small town. You gotta love it.
Meanwhile, at the plate, Austin Buescher has seen the count go to 3-2.
I think there's some signs and parades and restaurant marquees and bank marquees singing the praise of the Tuscola athletes this weekend.
And for the third time today, a St. Anthony batter goes down looking on strikes. This time it's Austin Buescher.
Dylan Hall just paints the edge. He has been consistently consistent. He's just been one pitch after the other, in, out, up and down. We call that pitching to the L. If you can think of the angle of an L and just using all corners of the plate, all levels of the strike zone, Hall has been pinpoint with his accuracy.
Now Jacob Lorenz will step to the plate. Lorenz, the second baseman for St. Anthony. Lorenz hitless in two at-bats yesterday. Walked one time, credited with an RBI. Hole falls behind 2-0.
You watch Hole, you had alluded to it earlier, Dave, with his windup, how slow it is. He's very compact. The only thing you might look at a little bit is when he kicks his leg out when he raises his front leg. Everything else, nice, compact, very slow and deliberate. And what that does is allow his arm to catch up to his leg, so everything is in sync.
The count's now 3-0 to Lorenz, just a couple ticks below 300 batting average this year. Oh, comes right on back, right down the middle, batting practice fastball. 17 walks, 57 innings. That's about, what, about two a game? Two per seven-inning game. A 3-1. Rip foul, get on that hill, that berm that all minor league stadiums have.
Got a big crowd in the ballpark. You always see young 4, 5, 6, 7 year olds rolling up and down those hills, having a blast, not knowing what the score of the game is.
Tapper to shortstop, Yoakum on the high hop. That ball died a little bit on the throw over, but Brookins held on to the bag, and then did what I think is a cardinal sin. He looks to the umpire for the call. Man, get your foot off of there, sell it. You mean, you got the out.
See a fastball, two-seamer that tails in on the hands of Lorenz. Yoakum has to jump up and get it. You're right, the ball died at the very last second. He dropped down with his elbow a little bit. But a solid play, a solid pitch right in the hands. And what's happened to Dylan Holick about three occasions already, he's been behind 3-0, but he doesn't give in. He comes right back.
Oh, what a slick pick by West John. What do you tell me? The defense is a little bit weaker with Hole on the mound? You can't convince me after that inning.
Racked that one up as a highlight, because it certainly was by West John. Nice pick, nice play. Three up, three down.
Neil Williams is robbed. We still have goose eggs here as we head to the third in your 1A championship.
One match away from immortality.
This is a total team effort.
We're going to try to dictate to you what you're going to do on both offense and defense. We're going to come at you.
One shot at this.
And now it's time to put the hats on and go get some work done.
So they're all going to look to make a statement early.
For Class 3A and 4A, and IHSA.TV will be there with you. Dave Fernhardt, Mark Lindo here as we go to the top of the third inning in a scoreless ball game. At the plate will be Tommy Watson, followed by Jimmy Knight, and then Dan Yoakum, 8-9-1 in the order for Tuscola. The Warriors, 24 wins and 13 losses. They'll be facing Reed Willenborg, who's had his way. In fact, both pitchers, they've had their way. They've done a great job. But this was a very interesting year, kind of a breakthrough year for Illinois high school baseball in terms of bat limitations and the impact that it could have on offenses.
Well, you know, we went from anything before 1975 and before the old wooden bat era, you know, the old days, if you will. And then we went from the wooden bat to an aluminum bat, and it was aluminum. The ball really didn't jump off that bat, but they didn't break. As technology has gone on and on and on, the bats became lighter, more powerful, almost to the point where bats became a weapon. Offensive numbers went up immensely in both the collegiate and high school game. And so the Federation decided to do something with that. Now they're using a composite, what we call BB core bat.
Watson will draw the leadoff walk.
Freshman gets this inning going for Tuscola. And with the BB core bats, which are a composite bat, the ball does not jump off like it did with the aluminum bats, with the alloy. It does not, you know, a pop-up doesn't become a base hit, a double doesn't become a home run anymore. It's really changed the coaching philosophy. We'll touch on that after this would-be bunt.
Knight looking to bunt for a base hit in addition to advancing Watson on to second base. Jimmy Knight at the plate.
So what it is from a coaching standpoint, you're playing the game much differently than you did just a year ago. More bunts, more sacrifice bunts, more stolen bases, back like the old days, instead of saying, okay, we got a little bit of breeze, let the ball jump off the bat and leave the yard.
Now, this would be a bunting situation no matter what type of bat. If Jimmy Knight brought a super turbocharged bat to the plate, I think he'd be bunting in this situation. And now time is called defensively. Not sure which St. Anthony player initiated that. Or maybe it was Duff Hole, as he will have a conversation with Jimmy Knight. So he said the Tuscola team loaded with football players. Philip Meyer, the center fielder, he was a quarterback, all-state quarterback, 27 touchdown passes and over 2,400 yards passing. He also rushed for over 860 yards with 11 touchdowns. Knight himself, 8 touchdown catches for 674 yards. We talked about Brookins, Dylan Hole, wide receiver, punter, TJ Onstott, offensive guard and linebacker.
Knight only 5'9", 160, but able to make plays on the gridiron, made to make plays on the diamond.
Fortunately for him, not able to make a bunt go down. Now, depending on the time of year, you have two bunt attempts. They didn't get down. You know the guy can bunt. You give him that bunt sign one more time. Does your philosophy, I mean, some people do that. Does your philosophy change? If you feel that way, does it change in a state championship game?
Personally, I think if I want that man to bunt, and I think he's a solid bunter, I'm going to make him bunt again. I'm going to make him bunt one time, two times, three times. In theory, your odds just increased if you're a good bunter that you're going to get it done the third time.
Knight swinging away, and this is an opportunity for a double play. Lorenz to Hecht. Ring it up. 463, and a good-looking one at that.
Well, this all starts with the feed by Lorenz. You see the pitch inside out. He hits the ball pretty well the other way after not getting that bunt down. And now watch the side feed. Great job. And in stride, Heck comes across the base. It all started with Jacob Lorenz with the feed. Taylor made 463 and out.
To the top of the order, and Dan Yoakum, he led off this game with the walk. We've had our third place 1A game, won by Alton Marquette, 6-2 over Lena Winslow, scoring all six runs in the bottom of the sixth inning. And here early on in this one, and I think we've had three different situations where a sacrifice bunt has not been put down, and all of a sudden the inning kind of disintegrates a little bit. Now Yoakum may have something to say about that as he gets the two-out single.
So you had a bunt situation when the freshman eight-hitter Tommy Watson got on, erased on a double play. Now you have a definitive run situation with two outs to try to get something moving, be creative with Philip Meyer at the bat, who handles it really well.
Yoakum, an average size lead. He stays. Philip Meyer at the plate.
Duff Howell told us, in a normal bunt situation, quite often I'll hit. In a normal hit situation, quite often I'll bunt. Expect me to do the unexpected. Now, if we can get a camera on the runner on first, Yoakum, the previous pitch, his feet were square. This one, he tipped himself off a little bit. He dropped his right foot just a bit.
There goes Yoakum. The throw down. And Yoakum is in there with his 38th stolen base of the year and 38 attempts. That may have been one of the closer ones. Unable to hold on to the ball was Hecht. I think the throw may have beaten him from Eli Dahlenbach.
Absolutely. Now what happened here is it starts with a slide step. Yoakum didn't get a real good jump. The ball short hops the middle infield. Yep. You mentioned it, Yoakum's safe again. Now he did, he tipped that off. I picked it up from up here that he dropped his right foot just a bit.
Meyer to right field. Having has been a busy man. Each of the first three innings, Jared Having, the right fielder, has had the putout. So the leadoff walk is wasted. A stolen base is wasted, and we will go to the bottom of the third. It'll be 8-9-1 for St. Anthony.
By me. I'm number one in this class. I rule this lab. I'm number one. Hey, I don't think so. Yes! Winner! I am the king!
You wouldn't do it there. So, don't do it here. Sportsmanship. It's up to you.
What?
Jerk.
Tuscola hailing from near the Champaign area. The fans have come up here to maybe do a little bit of doubleheader action, watching the girls in the state softball finals. Now the boy is playing for a state baseball championship. Dylan Hole on the mound for Tuscola. First batter he faces here in the third inning is Eli Dozenbrock. Hole has retired six of the seven men he has faced, and he is following up an excellent effort yesterday for Tuscola by Jacob Barr.
Jacob Barr, a mid-80s fastball, throws all three pitches for strikes. All he did yesterday is win the semifinal game with a seven-inning complete game. Gave up some walks, but didn't, for the most part, they did not move him. A two-hitter for Jacob Barr. Let his defense do the rest. And two hits yesterday by Tuscola pitching, none yet by Hull.
Dozenbrock will look at that pitch just outside the zone. 1-2. Yesterday, Eli Dozenbrock hitless in his two at-bats. Just off the end of the bat to stay alive.
Same thing for St. Anthony. Yesterday, Ben Hecht allowed just five hits over those seven innings. And through three innings pitched, just one allowed today, so six hits and 10 innings allowed by St. Anthony pitching.
This one is almost in the identical location, a little bit higher. If you're souvenir hunting, I'd sit right about there, a little bit to the home plate side of the Tuscola dugout. Ball and two strikes to the leadoff hitter in the bottom of the third inning here. 1A state championship game, and Hole gets him swinging. Fourth strike out of the game for Hole. The first one swinging.
Soft catcher Tristan Williams set up a good 6 to 8 inches off the plate. And that ball maybe caught the edge anyway, missed a little bit toward the zone, but had enough giddy up to throw it right by Dozenbrock.
Now the number nine hitter, Alex Holscher, the designated hitter. He's batting for the first baseman, Charlie Schultz. Holscher walked once in three plate appearances yesterday. And he'll look at a big curveball from Hole.
So what Hole's done is he's changed speeds on his curveball. He's throwing the hard breaker, slider, if you will, and then it's just a straight change curveball.
You know, when you look at Dylan Hole, his account now goes to 2-1, you say to yourself, and you're probably even saying in the dugout, hey, you know, this guy doesn't have much. But then when you get in the batter's box, moving that ball around, changing the speeds, bends the ball a little bit. This ball is hit hard, and there's the first base hit of the game for St. Anthony. It comes off the bat of Alex Holscher with one out here in the third.
Yeah, well, you can change hitters' eyes. You can change the timing of their swing. When you can get them looking here, throw it there, looking here, throw it there, when you can do that, you'll be an effective pitcher.
Connor Green will come on to run for Holscher. This is a straight pinch running substitution. Holscher, the designated hitter. Now Holscher can re-enter later on to bat. But we're already in the third inning. You know, that's what jumps up on you, and High school baseball is, you start talking third, fourth innings, you're halfway done with the ball game.
Yeah, there's no doubt each coach is going to play one-run baseball.
Jared Having now, the leadoff batter. He was a strikeout victim his first time up. Having a 3.11 average on the season. Green back easily. Pickoff toss by Williams to Brookins over at first base.
You know, in full respect to pinch runner Green, Dave, I think you'll concur with this. A lot of times at this level, at the high school level, you put in a pinch runner because he has more speed. But he maybe is not as good a base runner, has not been on the field to play as much, those things. So the decision-making is much different.
Outside corner to Having. That last lead by Green, very short one.
Yeah, now the previous play, the pickoff attempt, he didn't see the baseball coming down to first base. He had his head down. So he's got to be very aware of where the baseball's at, where the defense is at, all those things that come with coaching, but also come with experience of being out there.
Having swings through it. That ball kind of ran away from him a little bit. Ball and two strikes. One out, Michael Cabas waits on deck. Having yanks this one, and that's going to find the concrete. Bangs off a fence. And now your youngsters, Mark, that you were looking for to roll down that hill, they all go chasing after that ball down there now.
Well, if there's a hill, the youngsters will find it. If there's some mud, or if there's not, they'll create it anyway.
Once again, the 1-2.
Seeing Green right now at first base, not a threat to run. You see his leadoff that once he gets back off the base, very small. So you're betting on the hitter right here.
Line drive down, base hit. Knight over to track it down. Green flying all the way at the play in front of him. He goes to third, and on the throw, Having to second. St. Anthony in business here in the third.
Having just a little bit early on the previous pitch that he bully whipped foul. This time he stayed back just a little bit longer. Ball up around the letters, above the belt, below the letters, and he was able to turn on it, drive it into the gap for a double. And I believe Tuscola in this situation is going to have to play their defense in. But as we mentioned, both coaches will play one-run baseball.
Well, especially with St. Anthony, their postseason run has been absolutely marvelous. They've only given up 5 runs in 6 postseason games. Only gave up 2 yesterday. Those came in the first inning against Alton Marquette. They've already pitched 3 shutouts here in the postseason. Only once this year have they given up more than 5 runs.
And on the average, they give up 2.5 runs per game, which is just unbelievable. That's not their run average, it's average runs per game.
Infield in tight for Michael Cabas. We've had this situation numerous times this weekend already. Infield in, outfield, especially in left field, Jimmy Knight playing pretty deep. There's a lot of room behind the infielders. We saw it earlier in a third place game. A ball just dinked into short outfield. It would have been a catch. We've seen balls hop over infielders' heads with the infield in. Michael Cabas, the salutatorian for Effingham St. Anthony. Right now, he's not thinking too much about that academic honor.
Don't think so, huh?
Nope. Tuscola fans wanted that one.
Well, the Warriors pulling the infield in just the bottom of the third inning. That is definitely in full respect to those pitching numbers that you gave in general. But to Reed Willenborg in particular, you know, he's been just superb so far. So they're saying, hey, we don't know how many we can get off Willenborg today. We got to shut it down now.
Squeeze coming up, and this one is popped foul as it was a suicide all the way. Kiner Green off with the delivery. But now the count goes to 1-2. And down at third base box, Kenny Miller had a little smile on his face. Not so much because he was a happy guy, just like, oh, we would have had an easy run right there if that ball goes down.
Over the course of the tournament, we have seen some missed bunt attempts by all the teams down here.
Fouled back.
And in this game, what's that, the fourth lack of execution on a bunt? And that's why there's no points up on the board yet.
Caught by the second baseman, Watson. Oh, what an agonizing moment for that young man, because that ball looked like it was headed to land softly in the dirt behind him.
That ball was not shot out of a cannon. It was shot out of a water pistol, if you will. But you just thought it might, fully extended was Watson. Now, Watson only goes, 5'10". And he elevated to about 6'1". Otherwise, that would have been two runs. And that ball would have landed in the dirt. It wouldn't even hit the outfield grass.
You know, and that when you look at that, Duff Hole will come out to talk to his pitcher, his son, on the mound, Dylan. You know, that ball, I'm thinking, if you're playing a normal depth second base, you probably don't even catch that ball on the fly. That's how softly hit it was. It lands in front, you let it roll a little bit to you, and then you pick it up, throw to first. Now, the conversation here, I think, with father, son, coach, player, was what are we going to do with Hecht? And they have decided to walk him intentionally. So Ben Hecht will be walked down to first base. And that will load the bases with two outs and Reed Willenborg,
who has 35 RBIs and a .340 average. But that's the kind of respect they have for Hecht. And it sets up those force outs all over the place.
First pitch to Willenborg. Good job of smothering it by Williams. That's the pitch that they started out Willenborg with the last time up. There's Williams. Tristan Williams. He was not the starting catcher this year for Tuscola coming into the season. TJ Onstad was, but football injuries have combined to put Williams behind the plate. 5'10 sophomore.
Got a great shot there of how far Tristan Williams was off the plate. Set up a good 6 or 8 inches out of the strike zone.
Willenborg, three times now, is going for that pitch. He struck out looking his first time up. He has the bases loaded here in a scoreless game with two outs in the bottom of the third. The cleanup hitter for the Bulldogs from Effingham, St. Anthony.
He's got to lock it down mentally right now. He's kind of second-guessed himself. Why did I swing out? He's got to lock it back down mentally.
They go that way. Ball up the middle. Diving play, but one run will score. Here comes another. Yokum unable to keep it in the infield, and St. Anthony has taken a 2-0 lead on the single by Reed Willenborg.
Willenborg, we talked about readjusting mentally. He looked bad and then bad again on breaking balls. He got another breaking ball. But watch this one come right into your screen. It stays over the plate a little bit longer. He keeps his hands back longer. You see the dive by Yokum, who can't keep it in the infield to save the second run. And you put the bat on the ball, and you have a chance to have good things happen. That's exactly what happened on that 2 RBI hit by Willenborg, the pitcher, who definitely helped himself right there.
Green and Having come in to score. Hecht, meanwhile, goes all the way from first to third. And with Austin Buescher at the plate, the Bulldogs have runners at first and third. Hole had retired 7 of the first 8 batters in this ball game. Since then, 3 hits and an intentional walk. Buescher struck out looking to lead off the second inning. lifted high in the air. Knight goes back. This ball's carrying. This ball is gone. A three-run homer by the sophomore, Austin Buescher, his seventh of the season. And it's a 5-0 St. Anthony lead.
Buescher put a charge in that ball, and the ballpark right now, electric. Five runs with two outs. It's a hanger, a spinning curveball. Kempis has back. I think normally Buescher would have known it, but at this ballpark, he wasn't sure. But it cleared with ease, and Buescher has extended a 0-0 game. Two-run single by Willenborg, and a three-run bomb by Buescher.
The wind, which had been blowing from left field to right field, another base hit. This one comes off the bat of Jacob Lorenz. It is the fifth hit in the inning. The wind, which had been blowing for this entire tournament from the left field pole to the right field pole, now blowing out to left field. I don't know that it would have helped, but it certainly didn't hurt that home run blast by Buescher.
Dylan Hall came into this inning with a no-no. And now five hits, as you mentioned, on the board all in this inning, and they're not done yet.
Ninth man to bat in the inning, Neil Williams. Lorenz the lead at first. Williams was robbed. A great play by Cam Westjohn his last time up. Five runs with two outs. Five runs with two outs and two strikes on Willenborg. Fouled out of play.
Yeah, you go back to that Willenborg at bat. We mentioned he looked bad on two pitches. And Hole just caught enough of the plate. If he'd have been off the dish, he would have gotten the strikeout. And then the next at bat, that was just a flat-out hanger to Buescher, and Buescher put a hurt to it.
Williams again setting up way outside.
I tell you what, when you have seven home runs as a sophomore, I mean, that's big time. You got a couple years left to throw numbers up on the board.
Buescher had a three-run homer in the super sectional. That was a win over Shawnee. And that ball's thrown away. Westjohn throws it away. And here comes Lorenz motoring around the play at the plate. And he's gone. But in the inning, five runs, all with two outs, five hits. A two-run single by Willenborg, followed by a three-run homer by Buescher. And we go to the fourth. It's a 5-0 St. Anthony lead.
This hard, it's no wonder 7,000 students drop out every school day. Visit boostup.org and help kids in your community stay in school.
Now it's Tuscola's turn. They've got some work to do. Down by five. Boy, that happened in a hurry.
Now, Tuscola's mindset cannot be, we need to get five runs. Uh-uh. That would be a poor approach to this inning. This inning's approach has got to be get one or two, get a little, stop the bleeding, minimize things, get ourselves back in position for an inning that can put us back in the game. So you don't need it back all at once. You still have 12 outs left.
Dylan Hole to lead things off. Number three hitter in the Tuscola lineup. Time's called as a ball got loose off the hill in left field. This is our 1A state championship ball game. Later this afternoon, we'll be playing for the 2A title. It will be Rock Island Alleman and Normal University High School. That will be preceded by our third place game in 2A when Hersher takes on Westland. Tapper foul. So Willenborg, you know, you go back to him. He's on the mound right now. You're thinking, okay, you look poor on those first two pitches to Hole with the bases loaded. You had mentioned, Mark, he was kind of questioning himself. And the next thing you know is, what, 5 minutes later, he's on the mound with a five-run lead.
Now the joys of baseball.
Scoop by Neil Williams. One out.
Notice when you get five runs, or any time you score, just that much more bounce in your defense. I mean, not that that was a routine play, but you just feel better. The out feels better. All of a sudden, you think, okay, we can take command of this baseball game. And this one just happens to be the state championship.
T.J. Onstott lined out to the right fielder, Jared Having. And Having's going to get another chance here. Right fielder will make the catch, two outs. Tuscola only one hit here through three and two-thirds innings. What's the magic number for Effingham St. Anthony? Four or five runs. They figure they get four or five. They're in business. Nolan Walsh at the plate. Walsh struck out. The only strikeout for Willenborg today.
Looking at things here, I'm just going down the line. I won't read names, but here's what St. Anthony's given up. 4-3-4-2-3-1-2-0-0-2-2-0-4-3-1-1. That's the kind of pitching they put up in order, game after game after game.
That really is amazing. I mean, there's not a glitch in there.
Well, let me take you one step further. Since the tournament, they've given up 0-2-1-0-0-2-0 today so far.
Backhand Lorenz. The one hop, the pick by Schultz. Oh, do the Bulldogs have it rolling right now. A 1-2-3 inning that follows a five-run offensive inning. Halfway home in your state title game. A 5-0 Effingham St. Anthony lead.
Every day, every season, all over our state, young people participating in IHSA sports are learning an important lesson. That everyone can be a champion by discovering the values of being on a team, working hard toward a goal, and doing their best. At Country Financial, we salute them all, along with their teachers and coaches. And we're proud to be a part of IHSA life.
Palm trees that have become legendary in Peoria here at O'Brien Field. a string of them out beyond the left field fence. They bring him in from Florida in the spring. They enjoy him in the summer. They let him die in the fall and winter and repeat the process. Dave Bernhardt along with Mark Lindo. We have a new pitcher for Tuscola, but not so new here to the state tournament. Jacob Barr comes in again.
He certainly does. After pitching yesterday, he came into the tournament 7-5, improved to 8-5 with that complete game performance yesterday where he threw seven innings, struck out none, walked five, but only gave up two hits in that performance to move his record to 8-5. A 3.69 earned run average coming in, so nothing to save him for right now. They need to stay alive.
Defensive maneuvering with Barr coming in. Sliding over to third base is Tommy Watson. He moves from second to third. Dylan Hole goes to shortstop. And moving from short to second is Dan Yoakum. Out of the ball game is Cam Westjohn. So Jacob Barr will go into Westjohn's spot in the order. Leading it off here for the Bulldog from St. Anthony. The same man that led off last inning. That's Eli Dozenbrock. If you aren't keeping score, I can tell you that five innings started with Dozenbrock striking out. Overhand pitch from Barr, lifted to right field, Nolan Walsh, an easy play.
So not too many times do you see a seven-inning complete game where you face 30 batters the day before and you're back out on a bump the next day, literally before 24 hours have passed by, but of course Jacob Barr gave the okay to his coach and said, give me the ball.
Well, Barr's that type of pitcher as he will face Alex Holscher. Barr pitched six innings last Saturday in a sectional championship win over Danville Schlarman. He came back and pitched six innings on Monday in the super sectional win over Tremont, and then throwing his work yesterday. This is what, 19 innings in a week's worth of pitching action.
And this will be, he has over 75 on the season now, so some wear and tear on that right wing of Jacob Barr, but he's resilient, able to bounce back physically.
Nearly got that fastball by Holscher. Well, Barr's a 5'10 senior. You know, he may or may not be looking to play baseball beyond high school. And so this is it, his last day, his last game. You know, he says, give me the ball. You know, I can do it. He's trying to protect the score right now. He's got to hold him at five.
Still had some pretty good bite on that breaking ball. Downward arc. When the ball rolls, you get in trouble. The ball goes down, you get outs.
Holscher, the last time up after that strikeout by Dozenbrock that started the third inning, he got a base hit. That was the first hit of the game for St. Anthony, and it was the first of five hits in the inning. Ouch. His bat has that ping to it.
Yeah, it does. It's good you picked that up, but you know, then you say, okay, is that a legal bat or not? You gotta wonder sometime.
Barr gets some swinging. Got a little juice on it.
Now to go back and piggyback on that point, somebody might be saying, okay, Mark Lindo, what do you mean it's a legal bat? It used to be the umpires would come in and check the bats. Now they ask the coaches, is everyone legally equipped? And so you might think they are, and I'm not certainly insinuating anything in this game. I'm just saying over the course of a season, I'm sure some young men have taken up some swings where they had a baseball that maybe it wasn't the new BB Corbett, whether it be on purpose or inadvertently.
Jared Having at the plate, strikeout in the first, single, and scored. He scored on Willenberg's two-out, two-strike, two-run single last inning. He's looking to bunt for a base hit, and that's not where you want to put it. Easy play for Barr, and an easy inning for Jacob Barr. Does what he is asked. Retire St. Anthony in order. We'll head to the fifth. Time's starting to get a little bit short here for Tuscola, trailing by five. It's a 5-0 St. Anthony lead.
What's your idea of financial security?
Financial security.
No matter where you're starting from, Country Financial can help you achieve it.
Retire when I want.
A wedding?
of my dreams.
Your country financial representative can provide you with a tangible plan to protect what you have and plan for the future.
Peace of mind.
At Country Financial, we always ask, what's your idea of financial security?
St. Anthony Bulldogs have their young fan section down there in the berm on the left field side. Boy, they have grown. That contingent has grown. I think they're just putting red t-shirts on any kid that walks in the door here at O'Brien Field. They're a happy bunch right now, the Bulldogs, with that 5-0 lead as we head to the fifth inning. Josh Brookins to start things. Tuscola first baseman will take that pitch outside from Reed Willenberg for a ball. Willenberg has only allowed one hit. He has struck out one, walked two. And it's 2-0. How early do you start taking a strike?
You know, probably right now. Okay. In all honesty. And what that's called for fans listening and watching, it's called catch-up baseball. And what you're trying to do there is when you get ahead on the count.
Oh!
Oh, error on the booth right next to us. Big time play.
It was in his
grasp, the Effingham radio station, with a big time error. I'm glad for the Effingham fans that they're not playing defense for
that. There. Well, see, our windows are closed, so we don't get a chance because our windows won't stay open at all, honestly.
There it is.
There, right there to the...
Yeah, to where I'm waving.
Yeah, at the left of Mark Lindo. That's where the ball came through in a wide open window.
Now, we're going to that point of taking a strike. You need runners. You want to get into the pitch count of Reed Willenberg. You want to make sure that, you know, if you get a walk or two, it starts to play on the mental part of the pitcher. So you got to do something to make him throw some pitches and try to get some runners.
Swinging, missing, striking out. Josh Brookins, second strikeout of the day for Willenberg.
99 coming in, only two today. But with bite away from the barrel of the bat like that ball had, he'll pick up some more.
Now Jacob Barr will come to the plate. He came into the ballgame to pitch. Actually took the spot of Cam Westjohn in the batting order. Barr, no slouch at the plate. Senior, 321 batting average, four doubles and a triple. He's done that in 81 at-bats this year. Barr yesterday hit for himself, had a single in three at-bats, drove in a couple of runs. Actually checked that it was a double in three at-bats, drove in two runs, also walked. Hits this ball hard, and he's got himself a hit here in the championship game.
Just the second hit. Maybe that'll get him going. Get Willenberg out of the windup and into the stretch position.
Now they'll be able to bring a courtesy runner in for him. Austin Kokenauer will run for Barr, who will get a hand as he comes off the field. At the plate will be Tommy Watson. Watson led off the third inning with a walk. He was eventually forced at second on a double play after a failed bunt. Strike one to him.
So now with that breaking ball, somewhere in the mindset of the St. Anthony coaching staff is that Tuscola is not taking a pitch because of the normal thought process, okay, they're in catch-up baseball, throw the fastball and make him take it, you know. So they're playing it straight up like they don't expect Tuscola to be in catch-up baseball.
Sorry. Watson, the freshman. 290 hitter at the plate. Guardians coach Duff Hole really understands the game. He listens to what he's taught. You know, one would hope that would be a statement you would make to every player, every student. Doesn't always work that way. Well, we've had two catches on that right field side by Tuscola fans on the fly.
Yeah, that was a nice catch. That one, an Adam ball to the fan down by the tarpaulin.
Our third place game in Class 2A is scheduled to start in a couple of hours. We'll start seeing some fans for that game, along with the state championship game in 2A that will match Alleman and Uhi. Start seeing them filter in here in a little bit. Hersher and Westland will play for third place in 2A earlier today. It was Alton Marquette, a six-run bottom of the sixth inning to defeat Lena Winslow 6-2. Watson drops this one in front of the center fielder, Michael Cabas. And Kokenauer will stop at second base. So with one out, all of a sudden, Tuscola has a little bit of action.
Tell you, Watson, the young guy you just mentioned, he's wise beyond his years. He knows how to play the game. He understands the game. And he just took that ball, did not try to do too much with it, just flared it into right center field. Smart play by Cabas as well, as he came up throwing. He said, okay, I'll throw behind the runner and see if I can get anybody that might stray a little bit too far off the base.
You know, it's very interesting. As Jimmy Knight comes to plate, he bounced into a double play his last time up. Because, right, the normal play would be Cabas to charge a hard, get into the infield very quickly. But he was just very casual, made it look very casual about it. Actually made it very interesting for Kokenauer there for just a second. Jimmy Knight, the conversation with Coach Duff Hole. Bright sunshine here in Peoria, right down the middle. It's probably about the brightest it has been this weekend. We've had good sunshine yesterday, kind of in and out. Temperatures yesterday in the 60s, that's where they are this morning. Actually, I believe we are in the afternoon now. Willenberg threw it right where his catcher Dazenbrock wanted it.
And now with two strikes, and he chased it away. Dazenbrock might move even further to the outside. He wants to go up.
Right field behind first base. Schultz back, having in. That's a fair ball. Just inside the line, and the bases are loaded. Having did all he could. Schultz gave it a great effort from first base. And here it is.
You see, this one has trouble written all over it. It was a fastball. They wanted it up. He got it up. Somehow Knight was able to get the fastball up. Even though he couldn't drive it, he was able to fight it off down the right field line. And that just found distance between Schultz and Having. Runners had to hold because of the might-be or would-be catch. And trailing five, no need to take any chances, but the base is juiced right now. And as quickly as St. Anthony put five on the board, don't you think Tuscola can't do the same thing?
I remember in the third, St. Anthony's inning started with a strikeout. This inning started with a strikeout. Kenny Miller, the second-year head coach, out to the mound, actually in his third year. Settle his team down, and that's somewhat what you had to do there. Other than Barr hit the ball pretty well. The last two hits have not been that hard, but you just have to settle your team down. You know, listen, it's not like they're shooting rockets all over the field here, but the order comes back to the top. Dan Yoakum, the leadoff hitter. He's one for one today, a single, a walk. He's also stolen a base. One out, base is loaded. We're in the fifth of the 1A championship.
I can tell you that most coaches during that conference would have said, guys, we'll trade a run for an out. We'll trade a run for an out. Just stay out of a big inning. You got a five-run lead, throw a fly ball, what have you. Just get the next hitter.
Yoakum fouls it back. This comes up short of the second level here at O'Brien Field. Well, this is one of those make-or-break innings right now for Tuscola. This may be your one shot you get.
Yeah, the table is set, so you got to bring home to dinner right now.
Big gap in right center field. Yoakum the chopper. A run will score. They'll get the out at second. Cannot turn it at first. Good effort by Lorenz. That would have been something had it been able to turn that one, but it will be an RBI fielder's choice for Dan Yoakum. And Tuscola picks up their first run. It's a 5-1 game.
There's the first trade and out for a run. So you get one more out, you stand up a big inning, very, very little damage done. So this now becomes, you talk about the first opportunity. Philip Meyer, I think, carries the biggest at bat in the game for Tuscola right now.
Willenberg will start him with a fastball in the outside corner. Two gone in the inning, one run in, still runners at first and third. Austin Kochenauer, who had been running for Jacob Barr, scores the run. Watson's at third. Yoakum at first, and very quickly, Meyer down on the count, 0-2.
Gas above his hands, he got the chain to chase. A lot of times you'll see a pitcher go ahead and climb the ladder, go one more ball up.
Go high, miss high.
Got to give that one a chance. You got to just be right above the letters on that pitch around the neck area. If you go above the head, you won't get a guy to chase that pitch.
Swing and a miss. Meyer goes down swinging. So with the bases loaded and just one out, Tuscola only able to get one run. They had three hits in the inning, back to back to back. We head to the bottom of the fifth. St. Anthony up by four. 5-1 in your 1A championship game.
Hey, great party.
Oh, thanks. Here you go. One hamburger, medium well.
This is well done.
No. That's medium well.
What? Are you calling me a liar? This thing is practically burned.
That's it. You're not going to come to my house and tell me how to cook a hamburger.
You wouldn't do it there.
You gotta be crazy.
So don't do it here. Sportsmanship. It's up to you.
Cool but pleasant weather here in Peoria this weekend. This is day two of our two-day stint in Peoria. We'll head it off to Joliet next weekend and bring you the Class 3A and 4A matchups on IHSA.tv. Dave Bernhardt along with Mark Lindo here is playing this 1A title ball game, Effingham St. Anthony. First time they've been here, they finished fourth and third in 1991 and 92. This season with their record of 30 wins, 8 losses, a tie. They've set a school record for baseball wins, and this ball is hit hard by Cabas, center fielder. Cannot come up with it. Philip Meyer tried to track it down. Cabas on the move. He's already hit second base. They need a good relay. They get it, but Cabas has himself a stand-up triple to start the fifth inning.
Oh, boy, it was great to see Philip Meyer stay with that ball, stay with that ball, stay with that ball. But even with his speed, he could not outrun the charge in this baseball. Once it eluded him, it was Cabas to the races. And I think for just a silly second, they thought Kenny Miller did about sending him. But with nobody out, no need to. If there were two outs, we might have seen an inside the park home run attempt.
Ben Hecht, he's at the plate. Intentionally walked last inning. Fouls this one up and into the screen behind home plate. Hecht with a .458 batting average. 34 runs batted in. Infield playing close. Shortstop Dylan Hole just a little bit behind the grass. Everybody else in on the grass. This has popped up to the right side. A lot of room here between second baseman Yoakum. And Yoakum cannot come up with it. It will drop. And in to score will be Cabas. And it's a 6-1 lead for St. Anthony. They get that run back they gave up in the first, within their first two batters here in the bottom of the fifth inning.
Scored as a hit, a pretty tough play for Yoakum. He got spun around two different times. Don't know if the wind had something to do with it. With the infield playing in, he had to drop step right away on what normally would have been a pop-up that you described before. He had a long way to go for that baseball. Heck, gets a bat on the ball, a high curveball. Doesn't like it, but now you see Yoakum battling, and can't finish the deal.
Once again, that becomes a pretty much a routine catch if the infield is playing back, but that's the chances that you take. You need to play in to squeeze that run off at the plate. Now we go to Willenborg. He had one of the two big hits in the third inning. He had that two-out, two-strike, two-run single. It actually was kept in the infield, but drove in two, and it gave St. Anthony the 2-0 lead. Now you look for teams that build a lot of momentum heading into the state playoffs. Well, St. Anthony kind of went against the book on that one. Their last nine games, only 3 wins, 5 losses, and a tie. In fact, they had a rough go of it, the Effingham City Tournament against the Flaming Hearts from Effingham High School. They won one of the two games, but they were one hit in the two losses, only scoring one run combined in those two games.
And then the run started with a 6-0 win over North Clay to start the tournament. Since then, they've been in full control of their own destiny.
Runner goes, throw down. Hecht out on a steal.
Great release by Tristan Williams. He came up, he had a good pitch to work with. It was a ball that was up, got him out of his crouch in a hurry. Hecht with pretty good speed. Nice shot of Williams there. Good looking young catcher. See the ball up? Tried to protect on the swing, but to no avail. And a very solid tag by Yoakum to finish the deal.
That's the first out of the inning. Reed Willenborg, the strikeout his first time up. Makes a good hack at that one. Boy, the head of our umpires here, Brad Stern, sitting on the second level, unable to come up with that one cleanly. But you know what? I have to admire him. He didn't let that plate of food drop out of his left hand when he was trying to make the play with the right hand. Left side hole. Gets him. Two gone here in the fifth. That brings up the man who's hit the only home run of the weekend. Austin Buescher, a 3-run shot over the left field wall here at O'Brien Field. It's 3-10 down the line, but it juts out pretty quickly from there, and he hit it straight away left.
Well, you know, I have three tiers for my home runs. I have a G home run, gone, a LG, long gone, and a DLG. That was DLG, definitely long gone. It just was how far, and was it going to hit the concourse up there?
Just a sophomore, 396 this season, 7 home runs. Left fielder for the Bulldogs.
6'1", 160. Wait till he's about, 6'2", 185, and see the charge he puts in a baseball.
Barr will get a second chance at it. Ooh, puts his first baseman, Josh Brookins, in a little bit of jeopardy, but he gets out of it. However, the leadoff triple by Cabas, brought home by Ben Hex. Single, the run in the top of the inning matched with one in the bottom. There remains a 5-run difference. We played 5, your 1A championship. 6-1, St. Anthony over Tuscola.
Hey, great party.
Oh, thanks. Here you go. One hamburger, medium well.
This is well done.
No. That's medium well.
What? Are you calling me a liar?
This thing is practically burned.
That's it. You're not going to come to my house and tell me how to cook a hamburger.
You wouldn't do it there.
You gotta be crazy.
So don't do it here. Sportsmanship. It's up to you.
Laid-back fans dressed in red. That would be Effingham St. Anthony fans. And if they're an out counter, they'll be counting six. Six outs to a state championship. Remember, coming up later this afternoon, it will be the third place matchup in Class 2A. Hersher takes on Westland. And then the championship matching pair of teams with the same nickname. The Pioneers of Ullman taking on the Pioneers of Uhai. On the first pitch, Dylan Hull will fly out to Cabas in center. Bring up T.J. Onstad. Onstad has gone to right twice today.
Well, you and I talked last inning about when you start taking a pitch playing catch-up baseball. We had that discussion, and they come out with Hull and swing at first ball, fastball. But the bottom line is you look at your score sheet, and Willenborg's only walked one. So he has not given you any indication, okay, I'm going to be wild. You get some freebies off me. He walked Tommy Watson in the third inning, and that's the only free pass he's given up.
Onstad ropes this one to left. That's the fifth hit today by Tuscola, the first for Onstad, and it comes with one out here in the sixth.
Onstad went F9. He said, I'm not hitting the ball toward Having anymore. So he went ahead and turned on that one, pulled it, and got a base hit.
That will bring us to Nolan Walsh, a strikeout and a ground out for Walsh today. Right, the whole perspective has changed. They're going first ball hunting here this inning. Of course, this is your 3-4-5 hitters in the order. Last inning, you started your inning with number six man who struck out, but then 7-8-9. And it was 7-8-9 that got you the three hits. Pitch is high to Walsh. Did not like that call. Junior, 383.8 batting average coming into this tournament.
See his hands up off the knob of the bat. He's getting up about 4 inches with his grip, which creates more bat speed and a little bit more bat control.
Willenberg has to hurry to go to second for one. Relay two. 1-6-3, second double play turned by St. Anthony today, and it closes out the sixth inning. No runs, a hit, no errors, and nobody left. A five-run lead with the Bulldogs coming to bat in the bottom of the sixth. Willenberg doing it with the arm, the glove, and the bat.
So you turned on air?
I thought I turned the dial. Turned the dial in.
Up, college is hard. Down, those books are heavy.
My sport is football, but my passion is education.
Right up here.
So every year, I take promising high schoolers on a college tour.
Lights there, dark's there.
To show them that higher education means a brighter future.
My name is Namdi Asamoah. I don't just wear the shirt, I live it.
Find out how you can live United for Education. Give, advocate, volunteer. Go to liveunited.org.
Do you wear this?
You are looking at a very relaxed dugout here with a five-run lead. Bottom of the sixth inning, just three outs away from the state baseball championship and a fulfillment of the promise to the seniors that they would win their last game of the season. And St. Anthony comes to bat against Jacob Barr after scoring a run in the fifth after that big five-run third inning. They will start it here with Jacob Lorenz, and he will drop it into short right field for his second hit of the day and the eighth of this game for St. Anthony.
St. Anthony with this thing well in hand. Be interesting right now to see if Neil Williams is called on to bunt, play one-run baseball, or if they decide they can play for a big inning. You are in the seven hole with 8 and 9 coming up. Might change the philosophy of Kenny Miller, coaching at third, who's just gone through the series of signs.
Neil Williams today has been robbed by third baseman at the time, Cam Westjohn, and then reached on a throwing error by Westjohn. So I guess if I'm the current third baseman, Tommy Watson, I'm on my toes here. Check swing. Barr gets the one. Not two. Well, that would have been a 1-4-3 double play had we spun it. Fielder's choice puts Williams on and brings up number 8 hitter Eli Dozenbrock.
Now, the timing of that one was thrown off a little bit. Barr stumbled. You think you would want that to go to Dylan Hull coming across the base. A, he has his momentum going toward first, and B, a stronger throwing arm. Yoakum took that ball to the shortstop side of second, was not able to get anything behind that throw.
Now we have a pinch hitter for Dozenbrock. Kenny Miller will bring in Zach Gardewine. Freshman Gardewine pitched some key innings here this season. Gardewine with a 7-2 record, 55 innings pitched.
But only 5 at bats, 1-for-5 on the season.
Well, that goes to show you the depth here of the pitching staff for St. Anthony. You had Hecht yesterday, Willenberg today. You had Gardewine if you needed him. Gardewine, a 1.15 earned run average and 55 innings pitched, 7-2. He gets to bat here in the state championship game with his team up by 5. Barr from the stretch. Rolls it out to hole. 6-4-3. Double plays in the top and bottom of the sixth inning. But the St. Anthony fans come to their feet. They know they are just 3 outs away from claiming their first state baseball championship. We will head to the seventh. Tuscola needs 5 to keep it alive. Keep waving that banner, that flag, that rug, whatever material that may be. They may be waving it for a state champion.
Might be a magic carpet, because it's been a magic carpet ride. And if that flag is waving, they have a chance to maybe make a flag that says State Champs 2012 that will be somewhere on a pole at their ballpark.
And to start it here against Reed Willenberg, who's gone all the way, scattered five hits. It'll be Josh Brookins, one of the five senior football players on this team. Members of a state championship football team in 2009 and then a second place finish in 2010 and then this previous fall. They do not want to finish second here in baseball, but they are just three outs away from that very distinction.
Ben Hecht playing shortstop today, gave up two runs yesterday, complete game performance, and Willenberg only one on the board thus far. Three runs in 13 innings against St. Anthony pitching.
Well, and that's, as you mentioned earlier, the three run matches of three runs they gave up through the first five playoff games.
Seemed like a little bit of a recipe to get to the state finals and within three outs in the championship.
Six runs in seven games.
That's quite a run of pitching and defense.
Full count now to Brookins. Tried to overthrow that one a bit, and Brookins will head down to first.
Yeah, that's exactly right. He tried to go for a punch out, stay within himself. That's the only mental breakdown that I think he's had this game, and that was a mental breakdown, which caused the physical breakdown of his mechanics of his pitch.
And that was Willenberg's 87th pitch. He's thrown 55 of them, four strikes. That's through six innings plus one batter, and now Jacob Barr singled and scored. He scored the only Tuscola run that came last inning on a ground out by Dan Yoakum.
You see Willenberg, he's going to check the runner, Brookie, at first. No need to. Full focus home right now.
Over at first base, Charlie Schultz holding Brookins on. Some would say, let's not hold on in this situation. You have a four-run lead. Brookins doesn't mean anything. And now they will not.
Yeah.
We must have our audio into the dugout of Effingham St. Anthony. I'm not sure that Kenny Miller needs my thoughts.
That's if he decides to steal a base, it'll be called indifference.
Barr rifles it to left field. Boy, Jacob Barr has hit the ball hard twice. Tuscola is not going to go quietly. First and second, nobody out. This is the part of the order that did the work back in the fifth inning. Tommy Watson will come to the plate.
The first man on base, on with a walk, followed by a hit. Pitcher goes to the stretch, and all of a sudden you got a little bit of excitement with Tuscola.
Watson today singled his last time up, and a walk his first time. Against Leroy, a sectional semifinals, Tuscola came up with a four-run rally in the seventh inning to defeat Leroy 8-5. They need five here this inning.
So basically, Duff Howell has already told his team, hey, we've done it before.
Willenberg, happy he came up with that short hop. That could have been trouble. One gone. Jimmy Knight will step in the batter's box, the number nine hitter. As he didn't do a double play, he was part of a streak of three straight hits in the fifth inning that led to a run. Knight will slice this one, right field side, foul territory. Haven can't get there.
We've talked at different times this weekend about pitchers with runners on third and second working out of the windup, and we gave some reasons why that's not wise. In this situation, runners mean nothing. Willenberg has been very, very succinct and concise as delivering the windup. Fully agree with his ability to feel comfortable.
Knight to left center field, and the center fielder Cabas has it. Nobody advancing. Two gone. And anybody who's dressed in red in this park is on their feet. Reed Willenberg looking for his ninth win of the year and the biggest.
Nothing like the last anticipated out of any championship game. Every pitch, you know, can be something special as the guys on the dugout steps ready to be on that field in a heartbeat.
Dan Yoakum, the last hope here for Tuscola, needs to keep it alive. Strike one. Strike two. There's that quiet before the pitch in anticipation. There won't be now. No balls, two strikes as Willenberg go right after Yoakum, but first, he must tie his shoe. All right. One of three seniors. Willenberg, Cabas, and Having. To the center fielder, Cabas. And St. Anthony becomes your 2012 Class 1A champions. And the promise to the seniors has been fulfilled. A five-run inning in the bottom of the third inning. All runs scoring with two outs. Adding another in the fifth, the final 6-1. St. Anthony used the formula they have all year. Great pitching, solid defense, and enough offense to get it done.
Superlative ball game by Willenborg. Got the big hit with two outs. Looked bad at his at bat. Let's call it as it was. But got a ball he could handle, just flipped it up the middle. Two-run single with two outs. And then Buescher did the rest, a three-run bomb, and opened the floodgates. Then pitching and defense did the rest. A very, very deserving champion is St. Anthony's from Effingham.
First time they've been in the state finals in 20 years. They now have a third state baseball trophy to put in their case, a fourth place finish in 91. Third place finish in 1992. It's a championship trophy this year. And for Tuscola, they were fourth in 2008. They finished second here in 2012. And you have, obviously, the range of emotions. It's a tough go for Tuscola. So many of their seniors, five of their seniors, finishing second in state football the last couple of years. But how many teams and programs can say that you've got those medals hanging around your neck for both football and baseball? And really, Mark, we look back on this 1A tournament, some really solid baseball. The Effingham St. Anthony Bulldogs, as we said, fulfilling the promise they made to their seniors, promising their seniors, we will win your last game you play. And indeed, that's what's happened here today.
They certainly did that, and they certainly did a tremendous job all the way down the stretch. We talked about their scores, regional, sectional, super sectional, and state tournament, just dominating. And dominating like a championship should be. Tuscola, you mentioned it, can't come any closer than they have a couple times. Some great athletes, a great spring for their community, and a very, very entertaining, well-played championship game.
So Kenny Miller making sure he gets one final piece of business taken care of, and that makes sure everybody's lined up correctly for their state championship trophy and medals. Well, that will do it here in our Class 1A State Baseball Championship. Congratulations to the Bulldogs from Effingham, St. Anthony. They finished their season with 31 wins, 8 losses, and a tie. Tuscola finishing in second place with a 24-14 record. Once again, your final score, St. Anthony 6, Tuscola 1. Now, we're not done here in Peoria. We have Class 2A baseball, third place game, and then a champion to crown in Class 2A. So stick with us here on IHSA.TV. St. Anthony 6, Tuscola 1 for our entire IHSA.TV crew. And for my partner, Mark Lindo, I'm Dave Bernard. Stick with us. More baseball to come from Peoria.
You're asking me a lot.